Tonight on Insight, who controls an elite athlete's body?
How close to the edge do you go in terms of what you do and take?
You go as close as legal and as you're allowed to go.
The culture of the club is you do what you're told.
At the end of the day, you're responsible for your own career.
Did you always know what you were taking?
100%, you wouldn't know. I didn't know what I was taking when I was 18, 19.
I've been down that path where we've got rid of people who service the needs of players.
The athlete's responsible for a positive test, and so they're going to wear the sanction.
Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Welcome, everybody. Ryan, you went into professional rugby league for the Roosters when you were 18.
That's
that
correct.
Right? What was that like as a teenager entering the world of professional sport? Describe it for me.
I suppose I came out of school and I was lucky enough to get picked up in my last year at school to play straight into professional sport. So it was always a dream of mine as a kid growing up to play at that level. And when you walk into a club with such big names and superstars and the coaches, you know, all you want to do is impress. So I think once you get there, you just do everything possible to fit in and be part of the crowd, yeah.
Okay, so who do you rely on then for your advice about what to take, for example, supplements, things like that?
As an 18-year-old, you're pretty naive and you believe anyone, I suppose, and I was one of those kids back in about 15 years ago, so you know, you trust the coaches and the sports science guys there and the trainers. There wasn't as many as there is today, but, you know, you put a lot of trust into these people and that's the way it is. You know, you don't question what they're giving you or to an extent how they train you. You just do it. You don't complain.
Mm. Looking back, did you know what you were to always know what you were taking, do you think? I mean, did you ask as a young player?
So 100%, you wouldn't know. I didn't know what I was taking when I was 18, 19, but once I got into my career, you start to learn that you have to do it more.
Mm. And how easy, I'm not trying to suggest you did anything wrong, by the way, I'm just trying to get a picture of the culture inside the club when you're that young. What would it have been like if you had asked questions when you were a young new player, if you'd said, I'm not sure I want to take this, or, you know, what is this? Would you have been comfortable doing that?
No. The culture of the club is you do what you're told, and it was a hard-nosed sort of thing, and you trained hard and you play hard and you got the results. Later in my career, I had the choice to pick and choose what I wanted to take in terms of supplements, so I suppose I did say no in those stages, but I never felt threatened that I was taking something illegally or anything like that.
Mm. So what sort of things did you take when you were playing professionally?
Well, they were more for recovery, sort of creatine was sort of coming in when I was starting and things like that. Just they were the main things for me, because you're training so hard that it's about recovery and doing it the next day. So besides that, it was protein and nothing too exotic.
Anything that pushed the boundaries?
I don't think so, no.
You don't think so?
Looking back on it, nah.
Okay, were there performance-enhancing drugs, you know, illegal drugs or drugs that did push the boundaries floating around in that world, in either of those worlds that you moved in, rugby league or union?
I never experienced them firsthand, no.
You heard about them? Did you know they were available?
No.
Were you ever offered them?
No, I was never offered them.
And so you never took them?
No, I never took them.
Yeah. Can you understand why players might, to get an edge, do that?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I experienced some bad injuries, and to get back to the level where you want to be, then some people want to take shortcuts, and there's a lot of pressure and there's a lot of money involved.
Mm. Andrew, you were vice captain of Essendon AFL club until 18 months ago. You entered the club at 18 too, so quite young. How much trust did you put in the Essendon club in terms of what you took?
Enormous trust, I suppose. You're a young guy coming into a football club, coming into an environment that you've dreamed about for your whole life, and you come and as we said earlier, that you sit there, you do your time, you look up to the older guys, and you put utmost trust within the people that are at the football club, because you think they are there for your best interests.
Now, Essendon's admitted that its supplements program may have overstepped the boundaries last year. Were you aware of that?
I finished 18 months ago, and at that time there was no real sports science in the club at that time. There was a lot of, I suppose, specialists in fitness areas, but the sports science element has probably really come on in the last probably 18 months since I left.
Well, the club changed a lot, didn't it? Training and everything. I mean, there were a lot of injuries, weren't there, with Essendon last season?
Yeah, last season they had a lot of injuries. They had a really heavy pre-season training load where they probably thought they weren't the right size. So the club had to develop, had to get these guys big and strong, and had to be able to get them to compete week in, week out.
Mm. And were you hearing things about, were players worried?
No, I don't think anything. There's been supplements from when I was playing. There's no players that raised any concerns when I'd spoke to them about it, because you do put the trust in the club and put the trust now in these sports scientists that they are there to do what's, one, best for you as a person and as a human being, but also to get you to that level to be able to compete without stepping over the line.
What sort of things did you take when you were playing?
Very much the same, recovery powders, protein powders, creatine.
Mm. And how much pressure is there to push the boundaries of what's acceptable to get high performance as a player?
You go as close as legal and as you're allowed to go. I think very much the culture of a football club. Forever I hear media and specialists come out and say that football club cultures aren't great for young individuals, but the people that you have guiding you through probably your more vulnerable years when you're a late teenager, early 20s, they're the ones who set the culture for your football club, and they're the ones who, you know, create great people that do a lot more great things with their sport than they do bad things. And I know while I was playing, there was no talk whatsoever of using performance-enhancing drugs, or wasn't even mentioned anywhere, so...
When that Crime Commission report came out, did it make you think back about what you'd been taking and how much you knew about what you'd been taking?
Yeah, well, you do. You think, well, geez, what was I taking? Because I'd know we'd get the protein powder from the club, you'd get the bottle, you'd turn around and I couldn't even pronounce the words on the back of the bottle, let alone knowing what they actually were.
Mm. And I'll ask you too, have you ever taken any illegal performance-enhancing drugs?
Never.
Mm. OK. Kelvin, you started a professional football career in your teens too. You played for Richmond until last year. Who did you rely on for advice about what to take?
Look, it's very similar to Andrew. You do put a lot of trust in your coaches, your medical staff, when it comes to that kind of stuff. And you just go along and often take what everyone else is taking. But
do you question it? Do you ask questions?
We're at Richmond, I don't know about Essendon and Melbourne, but we were educated. If we were going to take a supplement, that they'd even put up a presentation and show us why we're taking it, how much we're going to take, when we're going to take it.
And did you ever get a sense of any of the kind of things that have been mentioned in that Crime Commission report?
I hadn't never heard of a peptide before it actually came out in the media, so no.
What about you two? Did you know what peptides were?
Never heard of it, no, unfortunately. No.
Never heard of them?
No.
OK. And were you aware of them being anything like that being around? I mean, was there any sense that there was a culture or even a rogue element in the club that was doing or around, even in other clubs, that were doing things that were a bit sus?
No. To be honest, I was oblivious to it all. I had no idea what was going on. And, look, we just presented with some supplements that we take. And that's what we do, and we assume that all the other clubs are the same.
Clint, you're 24. You left the Melbourne AFL club due to an injury last year. Were you aware of performance-enhancing drugs being around in AFL?
Certainly not in the AFL, no.
In other codes?
Not in other Australian codes, no, but you hear rumours from different sporting fields that it may exist.
So what sort of things did you take?
Similar to the guys, creatine, proteins, recovery supplements like BCAA, and just more or less, I relied heavily on good nutrition. That's something that I was always pretty positive about, being able to educate myself around exactly what I was taking and why I was taking it.
Mm. Craig, you were the rehabilitation coordinator for the Roosters and you later became the physical performance manager. This question of pushing boundaries and how far you push the boundaries, I mean, how close to the edge do clubs go in doing that?
Well, I guess it's up to each club, really, how far they want to push the boundaries. But, you know, I think everyone's very, very careful of their boundaries and they know what the boundaries are. And, you know, from my experience, clubs haven't really tried to push the boundaries up to that limit. So when we talk about pushing the boundaries, it's not like, well, we'll talk in certain amounts. It's pretty clear cut what you can and what you can't do. And so I think clubs make a decision, yes, we can do this or no, we can't. And I think for most clubs, it's pretty clear we can't do this.
Mm. Do you know of instances? I mean, are you aware of this stuff being around in clubs?
Stuff?
Well, peptides, the use of peptides. I mean, when that came out, were you surprised or was it something that you'd heard of before?
Oh, yeah. Look, you hear things. I hadn't heard. I hadn't had first-hand knowledge of it, but you had heard that, you know, there's clubs that are doing it and you suspect things. There was the calf bloods in news there a few years ago with a team, and you know you know about things in the industry.
Manly rugby league team, yeah.
Yep, and yeah, so you certainly hear about these things, but you're not privy to the information. You don't find out exactly what they're doing and what they're not. So a lot of it is hearsay. So,
David Parkin, you won 4 AFL premierships as a coach. You also played for Hawthorn a while ago. Given the high performance culture in professional sport, how much temptation do you think there is to push the boundaries in this way?
Look, I think when you're working in any professional sport particularly, where winning at all cost almost is the mantra or the culture of the sport, people will be tempted for fame and fortune or for whatever other reason to test the boundaries. And I think we're now facing up to something which I guess cycling probably faced up to 25 years ago and did nothing about it. And we've now got, we've been warned, I guess, the Australian Crime Commission has indicated clearly they're interested in the broader concept. So I think there's always a temptation, has been in sport, but we've seen it at East Germany and Olympic Games and things over a long period of time. And so when people are in that environment, there will always be a temptation in the role that you play to stretch the boundaries until you're caught or not. And I think Australian football should look at it that way. They are no different to any other sport in the world. So we have come to a point where this is going to be talked about. If we don't in fact do something, we'll end up as cycling did 25 years later.
Now, comparing it to cycling is interesting because cycling's in a lot of trouble. Do you think it's widespread in AFL?
I don't know.
And
whether
in other football codes?
We might find out from the work that's being done now, how widespread it is. I am absolutely surprised. I was gobsmacked when the announcement was made by the Minister for Sport. I must admit, I've been in this sport for 5 generations, and I've been very pleased with the attitude of our performers in our game and not trying to look for ways of actually bending and breaking the rules for their own benefit.
Mm. But you are saying that you think it's a good thing that it's come out.
Absolutely. If there's any indication at all, I'm one that thinks that people, sadly, and we might debate the issue of who's responsible, but I'm pleased that it will say that our sport won't go down a pathway, which others have, and they'll have to face up to something which sports like cycling have faced. It's been a tragedy, in my opinion, for that sport to have got so far down that track and have to retrack in the way that they have.
Mm. Jason Mazanoff, you've done research on some of this. I mean, how widespread do you think the use of illegal performance enhancers is in professional sport in Australia?
In Australia, we don't know because we can't get the answers we need. You've heard nobody knows anyone who's used, nobody's seen or done anything around it. I posed this question to a group of sports medicine people at a recent conference and they all said they'd not heard of anyone, they'd not seen of anyone. The best estimates that we've got put the number somewhere between 5 and 10% of Australian athletes use some kind of performance-enhancing substance on some sort of basis, whether that's regular or it's one-off.
This is illegal substances or...?
No,
because there are legal performance enhancers in a sense, aren't there?
There are, but let's remember that caffeine used to be illegal and now it's legal. So the status of legality can change with the stroke of a pen. So what we need to do is have a look at what people are using that enhances their performance. This is why I drive the question, is this a question about performance enhancement or is this a question about drug use? But in terms of the basic answer to the question, how many people in Australia are using? We just don't know. Drug testing is unreliable. It puts the figure at 2% nationally. In Australia, if you believe the testing figures, it's around 0.5%. But there are persistent rumours saying that it's more than that. And the ACC report certainly says that the problem is far more prevalent.
Mm. Who uses caffeine tablets or has done in sport? Yeah? And why? Explain to the average person why. What do they do?
Well, we used to take it in powder form, actually, before a game. Just give you that lift and give you that kick before a game, I suppose.
Darren Burgess, you're a sports scientist with the Port Adelaide Football Club. Sports scientists have been very firmly in the sights of that ACC report. How far do you push the boundaries at the club?
Well, probably similar to what Craig said, in terms of boundaries for training and recovery and physical resilience, then as far as I think you can possibly push, certainly my players. As far as supplements and things that they take are concerned, I'm pretty conservative on that and probably agree with Clint about sound nutrition can provide you with most of the performance-enhancing needs of my players. Mm.
Jeff Bond in Melbourne, you're a sports psychologist. You've worked with a lot of professional athletes. How do you feel about the way that this debate is unfolding at the moment?
I'm a bit like David. I've been around sport for an awfully long time. And we're talking here about club control over players. And I think to some extent we're ignoring the fact that individuals will do things off their own accord. From my experience with athletes, they have all sorts of people that they go to for different types of advice. And I know when we're at the AIS, we're always concerned about athletes taking supplements that they'd pick up from their local health food store or their local gym or whatever it might be. And we're always concerned about that and very diligent about educating athletes around it.
And how do you deal with that?
Well, it's a really, really difficult issue to deal with. I think it comes down to the overall culture of clubs. And we're talking about sports where the outcomes are really large. I mean, the players now are able to earn, you know, huge incomes and have fantastic careers. And I think there's so much money in sport these days that of course people are going to push the boundaries. And some of those boundaries can't be detected. I mean, we've known for an awfully long time, for example, that human growth hormone's been really, really hard to detect. And I remember standing at Olympic Games that I was at and standing next to a very prominent sports physician who looked out on the field and said, there's a gold medalist there. He said, I know he's taking growth hormone, but we can't detect it. It's a naturally occurring substance and we don't have a test for it. And you know, there was a gold medal basically won partly on human growth hormone. So I don't know. Maybe I'm getting old and cynical, but I don't believe we can just sit back and blindly trust that people won't push the boundaries. They will. I mean, bright young athletes come into sport, they're ambitious, they want to be the next legend. You know, in rugby league, they want to be the Dally M winner. In AFL, they want to be the Brownlow medalist. And they will do things. And sometimes the clubs don't know what's going on.
Mm. Is that right? I see you're nodding, Adrian. Do you think that's what Jeff's saying is right?
That players will do things independently of the club? I agree, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Well, you did.
Yeah.
Can you tell us what you did?
When I was 18, 19, I played for Western Suburbs. So in 98, I debuted and played 15 games. And in the off-season in 99, a local doctor prescribed me a steroid and I took it. And that was independent of the gut. That was totally independent of
the club.
They had no knowledge at all. So then I went through the off-season and I came back in 99 and it was pretty much in the off-season. So it was maybe 2 months later. I tested positive, so I didn't get to play in 99 or 2000.
Mm. How do you deal with the individual's desire, you know, to do whatever it takes to get the next Dally M medal or the Brownlow or whatever it is?
Generally, I don't think we've got the answer to that. In our game particularly, they're subjected to the most intense educational program that you could ever confront people with. Every year they go down that track, and yet we still have people with the evidence, highly intelligent, but have an absolute ambition to be the best they can be, will go outside what's being offered, hoping they can bend and break the rules and won't be caught.
Hmm. Do you know guys like that?
Oh, yeah. Young guys always think they know better. I think they want to be the best and they'll do anything to do it. So there'll be always kids like that that want to be better than what they may be capable of.
Yep. David, did you want to say something?
No, Gina, it doesn't stop the rogue operator, if you like. The numbers, I think, when I finished in 2000 at the Carlton Football Club were 12 people directly servicing the needs of players, my 12 little team of assistants. That I looked up in the annual report now is 34 people within that organisation who are directly responsible for servicing needs of players. Well, it's pretty easy in 34, Jen, I would suggest, that you could employ someone who, for fame or fortune reasons, will go and take, he becomes the rogue operator, if you like, within your organisation. I've been down that path where we've got rid of people who service the needs of players that I did know about because of
doing what? What were they doing?
Well, you know, we've changed them because they weren't doing the job in the way that we expect them to do.
Did that mean trying to give illegal substances to players?
I'm not really sure about, but there was some evidence to suggest that might be so, and we weren't prepared to take a risk that there might be somebody in the place that wasn't operating all above board.
So you smelt a rat? Or several rats?
No, just felt there might have been a... Well, it's a vague thing, and because of my position and I'm responsible, you can't allow that, Jenny, to develop. So we along, and I wouldn't be the only one. I mean, the coaches along the way who have certain values that they hold and behaviours that they think should come from that have made that decision in professional sport right across the board.
See, I find this really interesting. What are the things that... Where are the red flags? Where were the red flags for you in that situation? Because well, these things are very important
in
this
context. Well, yeah, you do that. But we opened up for review from our players. We asked them specifically every 2 years, anonymously, to provide us with information about those people who were servicing their needs. And out of those sort of reviews that not all organisations do, you start to get a smell and a whiff of someone's inability to do the job that they've appointed to do in the correct manner. And then you do a bit of homework and you find out that maybe we can find someone better to do that particular task.
That's really what we're talking about now, is where the buck stops. How do you see the warning signs? What should you be looking for? You know, what are people doing?
Pretty difficult, because in professional sport, as we know, that's camouflage. We talked about cycling a lot. How cycling was able to cover that for 25 years. Mm. So our sports will be no different. People will be doing things in a coveted way, but it's very hard unless you bought some sort of detective system into your club that you wouldn't probably find that out.
Anyone else had a similar experience to this? I'm interested, Darren.
Even then, it would be... You could bring in detectives and it'd be impossible to catch a player who's gone outside of the club environment.
Has anyone else had an experience like that inside a club where they've suspected something? What about as a doctor? I mean, you've worked as a doctor across a number of different
sporting groups. With Olympic level sports over at Australian team level, and I've worked at AFL level at a time when David was coaching. And I think that sports changed enormously in the demands on the sport, and it's interesting. I mean, this word rogue's come up a bit about rogue people doing things, and whether it's a rogue doctor or whether it's a sports scientist. And so they're going to look at areas, whether it's strength or whether it's recovery techniques or whether it's just their speed. And so there's all these extra assistants and experts that come in that aren't necessarily enriched with the culture or the heritage of that club, because they're literally Johnny come latelys into that club. So they don't necessarily have the best interest of the club at heart, because they're there to do a job. They're employed sometimes for a very specific
role. Well, they're
there
to get the performance, get the result.
They're high performance managers, they're sports scientists, they're exercise,
they
might be a nutritionist. They're there to do a job. And they'll come in and they'll try to impress. That's their job. They're there, particularly if they've come in making a promise that they can, you know, if you apply for a job and you say, I can deliver this for you, then, you know, you're expected to deliver it.
Have you seen evidence of that, or have you smelt other rats in your, you know, clubs that you've worked in? Have you got a sense that there were things that you weren't quite...
I worked with Adelaide Football Club, then I worked with Geelong Football Club, and no, there were no rats in those times. I mean, our biggest concern was whether we were going to give a local anaesthetic to a player and whether that was performance enhancing as a doctor to do that, you know. So that was the issue in that era. But you know, sport across the world, we know. We're not isolated in this country. We know that there are sports across the world where these particular performance-enhancing products are being used. So we wanted AFL players to use the latest sports science things legally, high-altitude training camps, nutrition. But suddenly, you've now got all these other available products, which are available not just in the supermarkets, Andrew, but you know, on the internet. I mean, the players spend more time on the internet than they do training. You know, so you can go on there and say,
about protein powders. Is that what you do?
Well, if they don't know what a peptide is, they certainly know now, because there are thousands of pages describing what a peptide is, because peptides have been banned in certain sports, and there have been athletes in bodybuilding and boxing who have been banned in sport for using peptides. So let's not pretend that peptides got invented 4 weeks ago by the ACC.
I think the sports scientists are being painted as people with test tubes and goggles on and mixing formulas to make players look like He-Man. And that's clearly not what we do.
Everyone talks about crossing the line. No one's ever defined where the line is.
Tonight we're talking about who professional athletes trust. Ryan, you most recently played professional rugby union. Who made the big decisions about what you took as an athlete in the club?
As I moved to rugby union, rugby league, I think through the years, sport got more professional. And rugby union, I think they were pretty leading edge in terms of sports science. So it was mainly the trainer, head trainer, sports scientists, coaches, and that really didn't have much to do with it.
And what about doctors?
Yeah, doctors to a certain extent. I think they were more there for injuries and sort of medication, I think, when you were... sick, but in terms
so it was the sports scientists who were the ones who were kind of recommending things to you and deciding what you should...
Yeah, definitely. I'd say they were the number one source if I had to go ask a question or if they were supplying something. Yeah.
Andrew, at Essendon?
Yeah, I think when I started, it was very much the fitness staff would give you your supplements. There was no real sports science element. It was sort of what everyone else was doing. We would do the same. But probably more so later on... sports scientists come in and probably had more knowledge around what supplements were actually...
Kelvin, what about when you were playing? Who was the person you trusted the most?
The person I trusted the most was probably the doctor, because he was a guy that if we had supplements, it was always checked off by the doctor.
So we knew
it was safe.
Yeah, similar. We as professional athletes are... obviously very privileged to get the teams and the support people around us for that education. But I suppose individually it does fall back on the player. At the end of the day, you're responsible for your own career. That was something I was very big on, was taking responsibility for what went into my body. It is your machine, it's your tool of the trade. So it's something that I personally as an athlete wouldn't risk.
David, how many people, you were talking before about numbers, how many people have a say in what goes into an athlete's body in AFL now?
Well, I guess it depends on the process or the structure and the line of authority which most clubs have. And I think it probably varies in all clubs across all sports. But for my time, it has always been the medical doctor. And this is the difficulty now. The doctors are... in our sport, part-time, essentially, on reasonably small salaries compared with sports scientists who are coming in now and are working full-time, very hard and very effectively and efficiently for large sums of money.
And as someone who's been a coach, how do you feel about that change?
Well, I am concerned. I'm a sports scientist by trade as well. And you would hope that within your organisation... anything that was done by a strength and conditioning coach or a sports scientist or a nutritionist with regard to the athlete was run past the best qualified person within the club, which I think is the medical officer.
Peter Likens, is that right?
Yeah, I think that'll be a really great positive outcome of the whole ACC's thing and whether it's AFL or whether it's other clubs. I mean, I think the role of the doctor has been highlighted in this in terms of athletes' welfare. I mean, traditionally in sport, the only doctor only got involved, David, when something went wrong. You know, that's when you brought the doctor in. And I think the core of the issue is the doctors who are working at high performance level have to be across all these issues. So the doctors have a responsibility to know about sports science. And it works really well at a number of AFL clubs who have been very successful, where there's a very harmonious relationship between the fitness staff, the exercise science staff, the dietitian and the doctor, and they all work on the same committee. Nobody's above anybody else. And then you've had, as David alluded to, some other clubs where the sports science people have been in charge of high performance exclusively. The doctors are there, you know, sometimes on a very part-time basis compared to the full-time basis. So the doctor's role has been emphasised in this whole issue in terms of performance-enhancing drugs and potential problems and injection practices and peptide hormones, all these things which, you know, the sports scientists, to be quite honest, knew more about than some of the doctors. And so the doctors have got to lift their game in certain sports to get there, and there'll be a message coming out.
How can they lift their game if they're part-time?
Well, because they have to be knowledgeable of the field they work in. If you want to work in elite sports medicine, then you have to be aware of all the things that contribute to elite performance.
We're struggling to keep them. No, recruit doctors into the game and keep them in the game.
Jason, why are you shaking your head here?
The World Anti-Doping Code actually forces sports physicians, indeed anyone associated with sport, to prioritise anti-doping over and above the welfare of the athlete. The code is written that way. For example, there was an athlete who had a choice between having an asthma attack and having too much Ventolin. He chose the Ventolin and was subsequently sanctioned for that. So part of the problem with anti-doping is that it actually forces sports physicians and other athlete support personnel to make decisions which could put them in contravention of the code. There's been a number of papers written about this in the British Journal of Sports Medicine.
Have the doctors lost power in the club?
To a certain extent, they have. And I think there'll be a real reversal and swing back. The AFL's already made that very clear in that code that it'll happen. Okay. And I think other codes are waking up, they have to do the same.
Because the Crime Commission has pointed to the increasing influence of sports scientists
but
as a concern.
But they're talking about what's happened in 2011 and 2012. And so the message is clear. I mean, that's why, you know, Richard Ings described this as the blackest day in Australian sport. It's not the blackest day. It's a great day because we've now got on the table things that people haven't been recognising as happening.
I think it's a gross generalisation to say this is happening everywhere because of what is allegedly happening at one club. And I think the sports scientists are being painted as people with test tubes and goggles on and mixing formulas to make players look like He-Man. And that's clearly not what we do. What we do is look after the welfare of the player and try and maximise performance. And that's not always, in fact, it's rarely with supplements. Most of these supplements have never been proven. We're talking things that Peter said before about recovery and looking to maximise training and periodise training. And I think that's why in the AFL and in other sports as well, the high-performance managers, fitness coaches, sports scientists, whatever you want to call them, have been given that responsibility because, by and large, player performance is a responsibility of a whole team of people. And sports scientists are educated sports scientists are the best people to assist with player performance. I don't like to think that after this, the sports scientists are going to be pushed back in their little cave mixing drinks and the doctors who, as Peter admitted, aren't properly educated to handle a lot of these training load issues, take over the clubs.
Mm. No, and I think that's what I was saying, Dave. We're talking about generally whether exercise performance has had an improving role in sport. It has.
And it's not
because
just
the
AFL.
The fans want to see that. The fans don't want to see the players playing at a speed they played at 10 years ago or scoring the way they did it. Whether it's swimming or whether it's cycling, they want to see increased performance. So the pressure is on the sports science people to come up with innovations. Everyone talks about crossing the line. No one's ever defined where the line is. No, this magical line, you know, so that we're trying to reach it.
Has anyone defined what a sports scientist is? What is a sports scientist?
We're in the process of trying to re-establish correct qualifications within sports science bodies. At the moment, it could probably loosely be defined as anybody with an exercise science degree, I would think, is classified as a sports scientist. But
is there any regulation around it, like there is with doctors?
There is in terms of university accreditation, yes. And there's a national body which is hopefully going to take over and make sure that all sports scientists are accredited. And they're in the process of reworking their accreditation process.
And I should point out, you've got a PhD in sports science.
And the thing is that ESSA, Exercise Sport Science, Australia is the professional body that is up and going. And I'd have to say, of all the qualified sports scientists with undergraduate and postgraduate, there's very few that have the qualification that might a doctor might be subjected to in his degrees.
And do you think many people at the moment are working who don't have those sort of qualifications?
Oh, most of the population within all Australian sports.
Really?
Yeah, most of them. I think I'm right in saying it.
Yeah, and that's been a problem that ESSA have acknowledged with their accreditation process, and they'll rework that as a result of what's happened, which is another good thing, and make it more acceptable amongst the sports science community to have that accreditation. But there'll be strict guidelines, and we welcome that for sure.
Yeah. Craig, what about in NRL? You've been listening to people talking about AFL. Is it the same in the NRL?
We've sort of been behind the AFL. I think it's been a lot more professional AFL than in the NRL. When Ryan first came through in the late 90s, it was all very simple. The staff structure was a coach, a trainer, and a football manager. You know, there might have been three or four people that reported or looked after the athlete, as David was alluding to. Now it's teams of people, of high-performance teams. There's now assistant coaches. There's now more physios than just a physio. And physio in those days was part-time, now they're full-time. So we do have that sports science element, but I don't know if it's classified as sports science. It's more, say, high performance / sports science, and that's how it's generally categorised.
Does that pressure to achieve that high performance in the team, I mean, do you think the combination of that and the potential for a lack of qualification can lead to rogue operators?
Oh, I'm not so sure in the NRL. They may have a staff structure there, and one of the staff may say, I have this guy who can help us out in this particular way. And it may be a nutritionist, it may be as a biomechanist, maybe certain things you may be looking to target, and then that may be open up the chance of a rogue operator. Look, I'm not saying it can't happen, but it's normally policed pretty well, as long as the head coach is over it.
What about, Craig, what about you? You're a sports scientist with Sydney FC. What do you think about the level of qualifications, say, for people?
Well, look, I think it's very important what ESSA is doing, the national body. They're looking to, I think there's only about 20 people at the moment that are registered sports scientists, with that across Australia. You know, the high performance manager, be whoever it is, it's the right person that can manage everything. But so many simple things beyond, people look for complicated things when really, a lot of the players don't have sound nutrition. You know, they don't eat well. They don't have good sleep habits. You know, they're not recovering for these reasons. And then we go for these outside the square options when we haven't covered the basics. And that just goes back to the quality of the people that you employ and the people that are in these positions. We spend the majority of our time monitoring the athletes. We know our athletes better than anyone at the club because we have all their data. We also collect pre-training data. We look at different things, how, physiologically and also subjectively, how they're feeling. And we look at, their recovery as well and how they're coping with that. So we've copped a bit of a battering the last few weeks, but I would just say to people, well, you've been dealing with the wrong people.
Do you agree with that?
There's a lot more influence, a lot more pressure on these guys, and they want success, and if they're not there, a lot of them aren't there the next year. You know, I found the turnover in coaching was quite huge when they weren't successful, but obviously when you are, then people tend to keep the jobs, I suppose. That's what it comes down to in sport.
I was going to ask you about this, Dave.
I heard Craig Bellamy at the Vic Sports Awards the other night accepting the Coach of the Year of the Melbourne Storm, who had been very successful. And his words at the finish were, we just do the basic things better and we work significantly harder than anybody else. That's the secret of success. And there were hundreds of people there, and I thought they're all saying, yeah, actually, it's not a bad philosophy, is it, when we're looking for all these edgy things, that I just do the basics well and work a bit harder than everybody else and you'll be OK.
Mind you, there is a small matter of the salary cap, but we won't go into that.
You've been very hard on me.
David, where does the coach fit in to all of this?
The coach's main role in this whole business is to ensure that the people who come in and service the needs of players are in fact quality people. And I think coaches have a role to establish a set of values and determine a culture that will attract good people into it and will work according to the laws and expectations and the morals of the game. Absolutely.
Who's creating the culture of
the hierarchy of clubs now? You've got football managers and CEOs, which, again, weren't as active, David, in your days of coaching. You know, I mean, you didn't have those people. So they're the people that hire and fire, right down to the statisticians and the, you know, and the people that are doing the logistics for Darren and things like that. So these are people the coach probably doesn't even, you know, he'll get to meet them, but he doesn't hire and fire them.
Yeah. Jeff Bond, you've been listening to all of this and you've looked at a lot of clubs in your time and sort of come in as the psychologist, as the sports psychologist. Who do you think actually is setting the tone for this sort of thing?
Oh, it's interesting, Jenny. I see it happening at different levels. Obviously, the coach is absolutely crucial. I've always thought the coach was the person that I was responsible to in the final analysis, even though I might have been employed by a CEO. But the coach, to me, is the figurehead. The coach is the person who should have his finger on the pulse. But at the end of the day, it's the CEO who I think is authorised to actually pay people and sign them on or off.
What do you think of the shift in power within clubs towards sports science and away from doctors?
I'll relate a little story to you. I developed a special kicking accuracy program, which I took to a number of clubs in Melbourne. And at one of the clubs, I thought it was pretty close to getting across the line, and the senior coach looked at me and said, how will the program run? How will we fit it in around our training? And I said, well, I'd expect you to identify the players for this special group, and I'd want to make a special thing of this kicking accuracy, and because I thought there was a great mental component to it. And I said, I'd like to actually have them as a group to practice certain things. And he said, would it involve kicking? Which I sort of smiled at, and I thought, well, I think it would have to involve kicking if we're talking about kicking aid. We said, oh, well, we can't do that. We can't do anything outside our normal training because I'm advised by our fitness people that the players only have so many kicks in their legs. Which I found really interesting. And so, consequently, of course, the program didn't get up because I wasn't prepared to do something unless it was given some special, location within the program. But I have seen the shift, and I've spoken to sports physicians at clubs who have felt it as well and who are somewhat frustrated by it. It seems to me as though when we talk about performance enhancement now, we instantly think of so-called sports scientists, which in my world is a generic term. At the AIS, for example, sports scientists included exercise physiologists, biomechanists and psychologists. I think the dietitians and nutritionists were associated with the sports medicine faculty, along with the physios and massage therapists. So we had that distinction at the AIS, but now we seem to use the term sports scientist pretty liberally, I think.
My performance definitely suffered. I lost my health, I think, because I was overtrained so drastically.
I think it's driven by money. We want to see people go faster, and I think we're all guilty.
Tonight we're talking about who controls a professional athlete's body. We've talked about football mostly tonight, but cycling was mentioned earlier. And Trent, you were a professional cyclist and you rode in your only Tour de France in 2008. Is that right?
That's right, yeah.
In cycling, who do you think drives that pushing of the boundaries, that breaking of the laws?
Well, the teams, it's the same in all sports. I think the teams are definitely putting a lot of pressure on riders to perform, and cycling's very similar to all professional sports in that it's driven by money and it's profit, and the clubs, you know, they want to have, maximum exposure for their sponsors. That is getting, I guess, guys to win in the Tour de France largely because it's probably the largest sporting event annually. I think it has the largest exposure. So it's definitely the clubs, but it's also the athletes as well, as we've spoken about. I think, like, one thing has become really evident to me from this discussion is how backward cycling is in relation to the systems that are set up in some of the other sports. And one reason why David was saying how it's failed, we have ignored some of these problems for 25 years or something. There still is no union for professional cyclists, for example, or no meaningful union with any power. So there's really, the teams can really bully the riders around into doing things that might not be beneficial to their health, overworking them or putting them back on their bike, as we saw a few years ago, to finish a stage in the Tour de France with a concussion.
Did you dope?
No, I never doped.
Were you under pressure too?
No, not directly from my team. My performance definitely suffered. I lost my health, I think, because I was overtrained so drastically from probably some of the sports doctors, or not so much the sports doctors, but the sports directors in the team were putting a large amount of workload on me to do their training and their racing schedule.
Indirectly, were you pressured?
Potentially, but I was always very outspoken about doping. So I think these people knew to never really offer this as an option to me because I would be against it, and maybe cycling's got this really strong code of silence that I think, you know, if you break that, and as we saw with the Lance Armstrong case, he would heavily bully his riders to adhere to this code of silence. So I think they would have been fairly fearful that I might have broken this code of silence and exposed a ring or a network like this.
So who was in control of your body when you were cycling professionally?
Well, I was, ultimately, but there was a lot of pressure put on me as an athlete, I think, to perform and get results.
Martin, you interviewed 25 cyclists anonymously in some research that you did. You found doping was widespread. Who did you think was driving it?
One of the things that you see in cycling was that there were different types of doctors. There was doctors who were in team. Unlike AFL and other sports in this country, cycling has full-time doctors in their teams, generally. And a lot of times those doctors were particularly concerned about health, but they're also sort of gatekeepers to try and make sure that the doctors outside the teams who were doping their riders didn't get their teams into the trouble. Anti-doping basically is about protecting reputation, I think. It's not really about health. It should be about health, but it's not. It's about protecting reputation. So I think it's driven by money, it's driven by results, and it's driven by, I think as Jeff said before, we want to see people go faster. And I think we're all guilty.
Where should the buck stop, do you think?
I think there's definitely a responsibility of the doctor, the sports scientist, the nutritionist, whoever it is who might administer a performance-enhancing drug. Absolutely, there's a responsibility on that person as well as the athlete.
David, where do you think the buck stops?
It's interesting hearing the boys here, and I can't think back to my career, it was that long ago, but when you come into an organisation, you're young, immature, have an ambition, live a dream, whatever else it's going to be, you would take anything, and I would, I reckon, take anything or do anything that was subscribed to me by whoever, doctors. As they get older, they start to understand their bodies, they understand the implications of taking certain things, and so they become a little more astute in their decision-making. You've got to understand men, their brains doesn't work until they're 27 or 28 is, in terms of the consequences of their behaviour. They're pretty stupid anyway. So we, on the basis that that has to be, then we've got to trust the people who are providing the information and servicing their needs. And that's the way it works. And so we've got to just make sure that we do have good people in each of those roles who do have the basic element of these guys' welfare at heart. And we've got a really difficult process, I would have thought, in all sports, trying to, to cover all of those bases of a young athlete coming into a sport who just wants to be the best he can be.
Where do you guys think the responsibility lies? Ryan, what do you think? Who's responsible ultimately?
Gen Y at the moment, they do what they want pretty much. So, but that's a good
thing. Sounding like an old man.
I know. That's a good thing in one way, because they'll stand up. They'll stand up and have their say. But it's no good for a senior player because they don't listen sometimes. Yeah. But that's just the way it is. I think it does. I think this one thing this is going to bring out is the education that young guys aren't going to be railroaded into taking something that they're not sure about. So hopefully, one thing is the education of those younger players coming into the program.
Jeff, what do you hope comes out of all of this?
I think a great sensitisation of the importance of governance and monitoring. And I think that's multi-leveled. I think we can't just look at players because they'll pretty much do whatever it takes. We can't just look at sports scientists because their job is to enhance performance, and it's hard to draw the line in the sand as to where the boundary is. I think the medical doctors have got a responsibility to be overseeing things. I think the coach, I think, assumes a really important position. So the coach has to take responsibility for knowing what's going on in the club. I think the head of football obviously has to know what's going on, because the head of football obviously oversights some of what the coach is doing. And then sitting over the top of all of that, like any organisation, is the CEO. So I think the responsibility sits at all of those levels.
Peter?
I agree 100% with Jeff. There's no simple answer. This is very complex and it's been going on forever to talk. I mean, the athlete's responsible for a positive test and so they're going to wear the sanction if they ended up doing something that's against an anti-doping code. But there are so many drivers of pressure to increase performance, right down to the general public. As I said before, we as a nation, we say we're a sports-loving nation. We love to see the contest. We want to see people improve. We want to see our team in Rio be the 10th in the medal winners. We want to see us back up where we thought we were in Sydney 2000. And we complain because we didn't do well in London. So the public drives it. And the corporate involvement and sponsorship is huge. So the code has a responsibility. It's a culture thing that takes ages. At the end of the day, the athlete's responsible to making a decision. And I think the education process is a hell of a lot better than it was perhaps when Ryan started, and certainly when David played. But at the end of the day, there's still other outside influences that have got to have a culture change.
Well, I think, and we've said it earlier, coming in as a young guy, I know early 2000s, the rule of the roost at a football club, you come in as a young guy, you put your head down, you do what the older guys say, but we've got a new generation of guys coming through, and I know in my last few years, guys, even if they're at the club for a week, they stood up and they had their opinion and their voice. So they are becoming a lot more, I suppose, outspoken within a football club, and football clubs are certainly encouraging them to do that. But I think at the end of the day, you have to be responsible as a player for what you take and the sacrifices and the things that you do. And at the end of the day, if you're going to go externally and take illicit drugs, then it does and should come back to you.
OK, we'll leave it there. We do have to wrap it up here now, but you can keep talking online. Go to our website, Twitter or Insight's Facebook page.
Hey, just sit right here.
Next week on Insight, a big taboo.
Let me show you something. Party, party, yeah. Let's get this party started.
We pull back the sheets on the sex lives of seniors.
Party, party, yeah. Let's get your body moving.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thank you, everybody. It's great.